Hi, this is Corey Franklin with Remembering the Past, the show where we talk about people who've died recently who've made a significant impact on history, society, or our culture. And we're going to talk about two men from Illinois tonight. We're going to start out with John Baker, Jr. John Baker, Jr. died recently at the age of 66, and he was a Congressional Medal of Honor winner. As we've talked about before, the Congressional Medal of Honor is the highest honor that you can be given in the military, and it was presented to him in 1966 by President Johnson during the Vietnam War. He was born in Davenport, Iowa, in the Quad Cities along the Mississippi, but he spent his formative years in Moline, Illinois. In 1966, he was stationed near the Vietnam-Cambodian border. The Viet Cong were smuggling arms, material, and men into Vietnam via Cambodia, so there was a big buildup of troops on both sides near the Cambodian border. Here's what his Congressional Medal of Honor citation reads. For conspicuous gallantry and intrepidity in action at the risk of his life above and beyond the call of duty. En route to assist another unit that was engaged with the enemy, Company A came under intense enemy fire and the lead man was killed instantly. Sergeant Baker immediately moved to the head of the column and together with another soldier knocked out two enemy bunkers. When his comrade was mortally wounded, Sergeant Baker, spotting four Viet Cong snipers, killed all of them, evacuated the fallen soldier, and returned to lead repeated assaults against the enemy positions, killing several more Viet Cong. Moving to attack two additional enemy bunkers, he and another soldier drew intense enemy fire, and Sergeant Baker was blown from his feet by an enemy grenade. He quickly recovered and single-handedly destroyed one bunker before the other soldier was wounded. Seizing his fallen comrade's machine gun, Sergeant Baker charged through the deadly fusillade to silence the other bunker. He evacuated his comrade, replenished his ammunition, and returned to the forefront to brave the enemy fire and continue the fight. When the forward element was ordered to withdraw, he carried one wounded man to the rear. As he returned to evacuate another soldier, he was taken under fire by snipers, but raced beyond the friendly troops to attack and kill the snipers. After evacuating the wounded man, he returned to cover the deployment of the unit. His ammunition now exhausted, he dragged two more of his fallen comrades to the rear. Sergeant Baker's selfless heroism, indomitable fighting spirit, and extraordinary gallantry were directly responsible for saving the lives of several of his comrades and inflicting serious damage on the enemy. His acts were in keeping with the highest tradition of the U.S. Army and reflect great credit upon himself and the armed forces of his country. So you can see that Sergeant Baker did more than fulfill his duty. Here is Congressman Bobby Schilling from Sergeant Baker's district reading about his exploits on the floor of Congress to the House of Representatives.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I ask unanimous consent to revise and extend my remarks.
Without objection, the gentleman is recognized.
I rise today in honor of a distinguished life of Sergeant John Baker, Jr. Born in Davenport, Iowa, but raised within the Illinois 17th District in Moline, Sergeant Baker served in Vietnam as a proud member of the United States Army. His selflessness and heroism earned him the Medal of Honor, Silver Star, Bronze Star, and Purple Heart as he bravely fought for God and country. Sergeant Baker would humbly say that this Medal of Honor was not actually for him, that he had done what anyone would have, that the medal belonged to all servicemen, to all veterans. Though he surely never would have said so himself, Sergeant Baker, the Quad Cities' only Medal of Honor recipient, represented all that is good about our great nation. And although he is no longer with us, the I-280 bridge, named after John Baker, Vietnam veteran, and the monument, will also serve as a constant reminder of who Sergeant Baker was and what he did for us all. Godspeed, Sergeant Baker. God bless you for your outstanding service, your remarkable courage, and your modest heroism. With that, I yield back my time.
Well, you'll notice that one of the things Congressman Schilling said is that Sergeant Baker would admit that it was done for his whole troop and that anyone would have done the same. And in fact, that's actually what Sergeant Baker said in an interview before he died.
One thing we all do, we wear the medal out of respect because we fought with the guys that should have received the medal. They died for this country. They're the ones that deserve the medal, and that's the reason why we wear it. Now, that's one thing that recipients, we didn't win the medal for it. We received the medal.
Right.
We didn't go out there and try to try to win medals.
Sergeant Baker, it's impossible for us to completely express the gratitude we have for the service you've provided our country. Thank you very much. We're going to move on to another Illinois native today, Don Cornelius. Don Cornelius died recently at the age of 75. He was a nice African-American boy from Chicago. He went to DuSable High School. When he came out of high school, after a brief stint selling cars and selling insurance, he decided to go into radio, and he got a job with WVON, and that was the Black Giant in Chicago, the big black radio station in Chicago in the 1960s. And from WVON, Don Cornelius went into television, and he became the creator and the host of Soul Train. He was essentially the Black Dick Clark. But his show, in many ways, was more groundbreaking than American Bandstand because it gave a voice to a lot of black performers and a lot of black artists who would not have made the mainstream otherwise. And for over 20 years, Soul Train was a mainstay of television for people who wanted to watch black performers. And indeed, like Dick Clark eventually got black performers on his show, Don Cornelius eventually got white performers on his show. Don Cornelius was especially known for two things, his afro and his great deep voice. Here's an intro of Don Cornelius doing Soul Train.
And now, here is your host, Don Cornelius.
Hey, Don, welcome aboard. I can guarantee you'll enjoy the ride, especially if you like your soul ice cold, because none other than the Iceman himself is going to be looking you right dead in your eyes after this very important message.
Yeah, Don Cornelius was cool. I don't think there's any doubt about that. He also had the coolest dancers on his show. He got some really great black dancers on his show, including at one time Walter Payton and Rerun. Fred Berry was on his show. But they just had a bunch of teenage dancers, just like American Bandstand did in the 50s. The only difference is these dancers had a lot more soul because it was, of course, Soul Train. And watching the dancers was always a big part of the whole Soul Train experience. As I said before, he got some of the top black acts in the country on. Here is Don Cornelius introducing some of the famous acts that appeared on Soul Train.
Soul Train, the hippest trip in America. 60 non-stop minutes across the tracks of your mind. Enter the exciting world of soul with guest stars Ike and Tina Turner. Aretha Franklin. His name is Bill Withers. Marvin Gaye. The Jackson 5.
Dancing, dancing, dancing.
She's a dancing soul. Godfather of soul, Mr. James Brown.
Babadoom, 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 babadoom.
Mr. Stevie Wonder.
I'm telling you, people, for your information. Soul Train.
World's greatest, Mr. Elton John.
Oh, can you run a hell of scenery up? Oh, the South spaced out. Benny and the Chess.
Great welcome, gang, Mr. David Bowie.
Oh, baby, baby, for a thousand years. That's what you and these golden years.
All righty, let's check out that Soul Train line.
Great welcome, gang, from Miss Diana Ross.
It's never too late, no, it's never too late. Everybody's in the house. R&D.
And for the mighty Rick James.
Yeah.
to love, peace, and
yeah, you got to hand it to Don Cornelius. People loved watching Soul Train black and white. He had a big hand in changing race relations in the 70s and 80s. It was definitely a changing paradigm, and Don Cornelius had a lot to do with it with Soul Train. Here's a little tribute from one of the greatest black artists of the time, who was mentioned before, Stevie Wonder.
Put your hands together, clap soft.
That's a nice tribute by Stevie. Not the most creative thing he ever did, but we get the idea. Very nice tribute by Stevie Wonder to Don Cornelius. Let's hear that great voice one more time as he closes out one of his shows.
And that brings us to the end of what we hope has been a beautiful trip for you and what certainly has been a groovy ride for me. We thank you for joining us. We thank our very exciting guests, Gladys Knight and the Pips, the Honeycomb, Bobby Hutton, special guest Eddie Kendricks, and of course, the Soul Train Gang. Hope you'll climb aboard next week on these same stations, and you can bet your last money it's all going to be a Stone Gas, honey.
Ah, you get a little bit of Don's boss jock DJ roots there, Stone Gas, honey. I'm going to close on that note on Don Cornelius, but the interesting thing is when he closed his shows, he always closed with one phrase, and we're going to put this phrase at the end of our closing song tonight. I'd like to thank my producer, Sid Tepps. Our closing song tonight is the Soul Train theme. It was written by Kenny Gamble and Leon Huff, The Sound of Philadelphia. And listen at the end for Don Cornelius' closing phrase. I think it's a good final tribute to him.
In parting, we're gonna wish you love, peace, and soul.